Welcome back to the show. Great to have you company. We're all used to seeing the daily cut and thrust of politics, right? But a new low this week, we reckon. One Nation Senator Malcolm Roberts sharing fellow Senator Jackie Lambie's private mobile phone number on social media, leading to a barrage of personal abuse, swearing and vile insults. It was low. Tasmanian Senator Jackie Lambie joins me now, along with 2GB's Chris Smith, who's in Sydney. Good morning, guys. Nice to see you. Jackie, to you, first of all, you've been getting any weird calls?
No, I have, after 17 years, changed my number. I can't put up with that. Look, I know that my number's been out there, you know, and I understand that, but that is no excuse in the current political climate to go up there on your Facebook page and put the comments that were put up there and then put my number up the top. You know, I'm not sure if that wasn't intentional. I don't know what it was, but it was a really, really awful move to make. So, you know, even though my number's been out there for 17 years, never had a problem with it. And you know what else really upsets me, though, Carl, was that people want to leave their messages or whatever else, but, you know, they're such cowards. They're all coming through no caller ID. Mm. That's how it works, you know, so...
To be honest, that may have been me last night. I'll get to that later on, eh?
I wonder, I should have picked it up.
Looking at this next campaign, it's already started. You know, Jim Chalmers the other day, live from the Shire, talking about the PM. I mean, it's getting pretty ugly already, this campaign. Chris, it's going to be a pretty nasty one.
Yeah, out of bounds by Malcolm Roberts, out of bounds big time, and now all of us news chasers have to try and find Jackie's new number. Like, give us a break.
Yeah.
But, Jackie, you were very hostile towards the Scott Morrison during the week, very hostile. I thought you were a little bit over the top because here's a bloke who paid most Australians' wages during the pandemic. He's got inflation down, he's got unemployment down, he's had a couple of royal commissions that he promised and delivered on, and, you know, net zero as well against all the enemies within the party. He hasn't done all that bad.
Are you actually off him, Jackie?
Look, I don't know about your Royal Commission, but, you know, I watched him sit in front of five or six mothers guaranteeing them that National Commission that we're going to do on veterans is much bigger and better than a Royal Commission and say that straight to their face and upset them. And in the end, we got a Royal Commission. So I'm not sure I'll agree with you there. This is the sentiment. I'm on the ground all the time. This is the sentiment that I'm getting in, the push I'm getting in Tasmania, is that they're not talking about this. They're talking about the lack of trust, the behaviours that are going on here, all the hidden stuff, the secrecy, the documents coming back that are all blanked out, all that sort of stuff, and I think people have had enough of it. This country runs on loyalty and trust. That is the way it is. That is the Australian way, and people are not feeling that.
The more division there is, though, the more the smaller parties are going to have a little hold and a little sway in certain seats, right? Take a look at this, for example. Clive Palmer, yet another multi-million-dollar advertising blitz from him, basically saying you shouldn't trust any other politician other than him. Now it's everywhere, in the Australian particularly, full-page advertisements. And is this, I wonder, Chris, that target market that Scott Morrison believes will decide the next election, the guys who are going to be in control of the preferences in some of these key seats that ultimately will lead to whoever governs?
Yeah, it depends where the preferences go. Like, a lot of the electioneers within the party, the experienced electioneers, say that he doesn't actually change votes, Clive Palmer. What he does, he sets the agenda on the issues about the election that's coming up. And that's a good one to pick on. He's right on the money here. Mm. It is about trust. It's not such a scoop, though, that we can't trust politicians. Like, we know that. But, however, this particular election, more than any we've had, will be about trust and whether we can believe the Prime Minister and whether Anthony Albanese is trustworthy as well. So he's on the right issue.
Preferences are always a very spiritual thing, aren't they, Jackie? I mean, would you take, for example, One Nation preferences ever?
We don't do how-to-vote cards, Carl, so I've never done that.
And not now.
No, it certainly wouldn't help me. It's not something I've ever been involved in. Yeah. They also changed the way preferences were done in 2016 to try, and so those preference whisperers were knocked out of the game, so you didn't get the Ricky Muellers and that up. You didn't get normal people in politics, which is really unfortunate. But, you know, that is not...
You're all abnormal.
Yeah, that's the one.
But the reality is, Jackie, it's easy to glaze over these adverts, but there's a certain power to them. Eventually, in a tight election battle, even the small voter swinging can decide it.
You know, the sad thing is, if they actually change the political donation rules up here, Liberal and Labor would have nothing to moan about. So if you want something done about this sort of stuff, then we've got a bill. There's other independents out there that have got political donation bills to change that will stop all this. But those majors don't want to have a bite into it. So okay. Go wear it.
Just quickly, and I think Chris raises the point about the PM, and you went very hard at the PM the other day in the Senate. And you got a lot of good press from it as well. But I wonder, do you really feel that strongly against the Prime Minister right now?
Yes, I do. And I'll have a little bit more to say after Christmas. I think he's hanging in with everything he has, yes. And I just wonder, you know, when you start to see people falling apart and it's really in our face up here, is my problem is his leadership. And I've never really believed he was a leader. So that's where I come. I'm being brutally honest here. I'm very lucky. I did serve in the military and I had some really great leaders there. And when you look at them compared to what I've seen up here so far, it's not very impressive, mate.
Really quickly on that, Chris.
Yeah, well, it is about... Look at the own goals that he has kicked himself in the last, say, week or so. The stuff about Hawaii. I told Anthony Albanese that we were going to Hawaii for that holiday. Well, no, you're pushing the envelope too much. You're trying to spin it. He had to come back and apologise. And that's at a time when we're just talking about whether we can trust him. So he does it himself, you know.
Yeah. OK, talking of leaders, this story, this is a great one, I reckon. It was a moment from this great leader.
Because I have a dream that my four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the colour of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream...
How good. Martin Luther King, 1963, gives you chills, doesn't it? Arguably the greatest speech in history. Roll forward 58 years, time to meet 22-year-old Eric Serge Hubert. Have a look at him. Jailed for 6 months at Newcastle local court for an anti-coal mine protest. And get this, his Instagram model twin sisters from Caloundra, now living in LA, that's a long way from Caloundra, are keeping it real, folks, comparing their brother to Martin Luther King, Nelson Mandela, and even more surprisingly, Rosa Parks. I mean...
Someone's writing their stuff for a start. They weren't alive.
I mean, these guys, these professional protesters, stopping industry, Jackie. But he's a great leader. There he is.
I'm trying to infiltrate into the younger generation, mate. I'm even on that Tic Tac thing or whatever it is these days. I put myself, what's it called? Whatever it is. I don't get it all, mate. Honestly, I don't get it. Oh my goodness. You know, I mean, I'm only 30 years of age like you, Carl. You know, so, and I'm still right out of the room here.
Tic-tac.
I don't get it.
You're the best.
What's it called? Is it tic-tac?
Tic-tac's
TikTok,
fine.
Something?
Tic-tac's fine. Right. Chris, you?
Righto.
Oh, look, the Insta sisters, someone's writing the material because they weren't even alive when all that was happening. And the Insta sisters sound like Twisted Sisters, I would thought, because he's stopping a coal line which prevents millions of dollars from getting to port. Sorry, he's in a jail cell for good reason at the governor's pleasure.
He's like Nelson Mandela. I mean, these girls...
Maybe they know something we don't cover. Maybe he's Nelson's love child or something.
Maybe something like that. Chris, great to see you. And Jackie, I'll be calling you at 9:05 a.m. So the unknown number is me, just so you know.
I won't be giving you my new number, Carl. My number's coming to you, Chris, this morning.
Beauty.
He's sad now, Jackie, and I've got to put up with him for the rest of the morning.
Dumped.
Oh, sorry about that, Ellie. I might give it to you, Carl, just to save Ellie. Ellie, just keep her peace.
There you go.
God, you're a wonder.